some of it's really, I feel like we're on a, on like this interesting, we're at a point in history now where I think media might start getting really bright. Like, you know, during the
I hope so.
The Great Depression, you had like Fred and Ginger dancing movies, and it was just people just wanted an escape from the grim realities. And so these incredibly fun productions sort of came out. And I'm seeing a couple of them. There's this one that I just saw. It was called Emily in Paris.
Yeah.
And it's about a young, impossibly well-attired, pretty girl, like, you know, going to Paris and having this sort of like crazy. It was just, it was ridiculous and bright and happy and positive.
I thought about watching that the other day. Is that you recommend it? Do you?
Absolutely. If you, it's wonderful escapism. It's very humane, and it's a absolute 180 degree contrast with things like Game of Thrones and you know, The Expanse and these brilliantly well made The Boys, like these dark awful things that make you kind of feel sick after you. That was really good. I feel like I have to go crawl in a corner.
I'm not sure how I feel about that stuff, because I feel like we have as an artist personally anyway, I feel like I have a moral obligation, and I kind of feel like everyone has this moral obligation to tell stories that are going to make the world a better place.
Yes.
And you know, there's a self-fulfilling prophecy at play here, like I was talking about before. You know, the more we're creating the world that we live in through the stories that we tell, and if we tell you know, positive stories, if we're optimistic, then we're going to be contributing to making the world a better place. And if we tell pessimistic stories, which lots of people do, you know, there's so many apocalyptic stories out there now, which I feel like it's morally wrong to be putting that kind of stuff out there, because people are just going to lose hope if they watch that stuff.
Isn't that interesting? Because I've heard, as you were saying this, I'm going, oh, I wonder where is he going to go on this? That's the way I go.
Right.
Because one way is like, if you just tell dreamy, happy things, then you're just sleepwalking into oblivion, and it's irresponsible. You have to be miserable all the time, you know, otherwise.
Obviously, it's important to point out problems in society, but always temper that with hope. If you can't have an element of hope to whatever your message is, then just don't say anything. Mm-hmm. You're better off just not. I mean, I suppose there are times where you have to point out atrocities that are happening, and it's there might be nothing hopeful about it. But when you're telling a story as an artist, I think it's important to be pointing at what needs to be done to make the world a better place, not just pointing at how awful the world is, you know, because of this one problem.
We're gonna do one thing here. I'm gonna move this around so that I can see your face.
Okay.
Arrange it so that we're making eye contact. That's good. And I mean, this is interesting. Like, your process now involves listening to the radio, I guess, or listening to podcasts while you're working, which means automatically you are plugged in. Like, what are you listening to? Sort of like,
I don't always do that. I often will just listen to music, and often silence.
Okay.
And what I also like to do, if it's a nice day, is just go outside.
Yeah.
Sit at the picnic table in the sand.
That's nice too. Yeah. Well, that's
listen to the birds.
It sounds like you're balanced. That's good. But I mean, I have a fascination with the world, and I'm very aware of a lot of extremely dark corners of reality, and I want to know what all the dark apocalyptic stuff is. And I find it fascinating.
Yeah.
But when I write, I'm not bringing that stuff. Like, that will inform. It gives you so much information that you can tell a very realistic, happy story. Because I know where everything is.
Yeah.
And once you know where everything is, you're not making mistakes, because if someone is blind to stuff, then they can't tell even a happy story correctly, because they get things wrong, if that makes any sense. But yeah, like, I find my work, even when I'm writing dark stuff, it's funny. It's upbeat. People are cracking jokes. You're going to come away from it feeling better about the world. And when you have that sort of hope, sort of, you know, burn in your belly, you're going to be able to face your day more easily. You know, you can power through a lot of miserable stuff if you feel confident and if you feel happy. Like, I actually, you know, even with all the crazy things going on, I was like, I'm extremely hopeful for the future. I think there's a lot of difficult stuff that we're going to have to move through. But I think we're going to be, there's a lot of great stuff.
Climate change is a pretty big one, right? That's, it's hard to see. the light at the end of the tunnel with that one, because for so long we've been destroying the planet, and there probably are a lot of species that are going to continue to go extinct because of what we're doing. However, it sounds a little selfish, but for us as humans, I think it's maybe putting the environmental stuff aside a little bit. But if you look at our trajectory, if you look at how much better the world has been progressively getting since the dawn of civilization, it's almost irrational to think that everything's going to fall apart and things are going to get worse when it's only ever gotten better. You know, there's like, I do a lot of, do you know Steven Pinker?
Steven Pinker, yes.
He wrote Enlightenment Now, and it basically...
I have one of his books. I haven't read the darn thing yet.
he's a good writer. He's a good philosopher. He's very optimistic. Mm. And so this book, Enlightenment Now, basically just shows all the ways in which the world has gotten better and is continuing to get better. And then he'll juxtapose that with all these, the media and these widespread beliefs that, you know, the world is getting worse. So he's pointing at the reality despite all the pessimism that exists in the world. His thesis is that the world's... It's irrational to think that the world's going to suddenly stop getting better, or to not see that it has been getting better, and to not be hopeful, to not be optimistic.
You know, continue. Like I just came across an interesting study on pollution, and there was outcry about the U.S. Withdrew from the Kyoto Climate Accords. Yeah. And, this one researcher was just like, yeah, but look, the actual pollution levels continue to drop because as new technologies come along, pollution's inefficient. You don't make as much money by being dirty.
Yeah.
And so with the more a technological industrial society refines itself, the cleaner. I mean, look at Elon Musk. Guy's making, we're all going to be driving electric cars in 10 years. Yeah. And I know there's arguments for and against that, but I'm going, come on, electric's pretty damn cool, yeah. And if you look at the nations that are still part of the Kyoto Agreement, they haven't gotten as clean as the United States. And I know there is a political bias there. I didn't have the time to sort of explore it, but on the whole, staying, being excited about making electric cars, for instance, is a it seems like a good step away from, when I was a kid, we had, acid rain was a problem, and there were dead lakes. Those lakes are alive again, you know, and that's just continual. We have, two steps forward, one step back. It's not an easy process, but the process seems to have a continual bend towards a very bright outcome.
Yeah.
That's what I see.
Of course there are hurdles. That's right. It's a learning process, but we are learning. Humans want to survive, and we'll do what we have to do to survive. So, soon that's going to mean that we have to, increasingly that means that we have to change, what we do to the environment, because it can't take much.
One of my favorites. I'm a tech nerd as well. Do you know what a lifter reactor is?
No.
Okay, so it's liquid. Liquid fluoride thorium reactor. So basically, it's a type of nuclear reactor, but it doesn't burn uranium. It burns thorium, and thorium is an extremely common element.
Yeah.
And one of the things that's neat about it is that it. It's a very clean reaction. Like basically, you turn thorium.